Hello and welcome to the webcast with CD Networks and Forrester, Russia Acceleration. Thank you so much for joining us. If you have questions throughout this presentation, please use the Q&A function on the ON24 console, and we will get to those at the end of the webcast. Wanted to just start out by welcoming Reinike Ritsma. She is Vice President and Research Director with Forrester.
Thank you. Thank you so all for attending. So let me quickly introduce myself. As Sharon already said, my name is Reinike Ritsma. I'm actually based in Amsterdam in the Netherlands, and I'm the Research Director for the Market Insights role at Forrester. In that role, I'm covering the changes happening in the market insights industry and how market researchers should adopt their research agendas, research methodologies, and team structure to continue to be successful. Part of that role is helping them all understand how technology impacts consumer behavior globally. And we publish reports about changing consumer behaviors around the world where we compare trends within the different regions that we cover. So today I'm going to share with you some insights about Russia. So we will have the following agenda. Because Russia is a very intriguing market, I want to cover it from a couple of different angles. So in the next 20 minutes or so, I want to share with you why Russia matters. I want to share with you what you need to know about Russia, some digital trends, and then a short summary to close it off. So let's dive into it immediately. First, why Russia matters? And why Russia matters to global organizations, and why should you care about Russia now, at this specific moment in time? Well, actually, very simple. Russia is a huge growth market. There's already a lot of opportunity for foreign investors, but the growth opportunity that's out there is very, very impressive. So let me show you some numbers. So this is it's a complex graphic, and I completely immediately agree with that. But if you look at this chart, you actually see that emerging markets, including Russia, which is green in the middle, have shown the highest online growth potential in the past 5 years. So this is an analysis from Forrester's technographics data combined with our forecasting data. And it looks a bit complex, but it shows actually the online growth for mature and emerging markets in the past years. So if you look at the y-axis, you actually see the online penetration of consumers in those markets. Where if you look at the x-axis, you actually see the growth within the online penetration. And then finally, the third element of this graphics shows the bubble, is the bubble size, because the bubble size actually shows the size of the online population. So having all that information there and process it for a moment, then what you, when you look at it, you actually see that the BRIC markets not only have shown the most growth in the past 5 years, because they're completely at the right-hand side of the graphic, like China, India, but also Brazil, Russia, and Mexico. So they have shown the most growth in the past years, but they also clearly represent a large share of the online population globally, which is the size of the bubble. So if you already look at the current size of these populations, Russia is larger or bigger than France or Germany or UK, all of these other European markets. So that's it has shown already quite some growth potential, but it's not only shown the growth in the past, they also have the largest potential for the years ahead. So if you look at this figure, which is an S-curve, this figure shows the relative position of the top 20 countries by the number of internet users in 2012. Contrary, for example, the US and the UK, which if you look at the end of the top of the S, you will see South Korea, UK, Japan, and the US. Those markets, these mature internet markets, they actually have already reached the end of the curve. The online population is saturated. But if you look at the middle of the curve, where you will see, again, Brazil, Russia, Turkey, those are the countries that there's a huge opportunity for growth, and it's also a growth that will come soon. How these countries on this S-curve, especially lower at the bottom and in and the line up, how they will move upwards, up the curve, depends on a number of factors. You have to think of elements like the affordability of internet services, for example, or the education skills of the users, interest and motivation of users, internet connection, like is there fixed broadband available or is there mobile internet. The country's infrastructure, very important one, are the telephone lines, is there international bandwidth. And last but not least, the government's vision on the country's digital future and related policies. So there's a couple of elements that actually define if countries move up to the growth curve and how fast. In our next section, we will actually take a look at some of these factors for Russia and how these influence the digital developments for Russia specifically. Oh, and this is finally the, I wanted to show you a forecast for Russia in more detail, which is the online population forecast. Because if you look at, and this is 2001 till 2005 until 2017, forecasted online population, you will see that where we are now, 2012, 2000, closing to 2013, is actually the moment where there's the biggest increase in growth. So there's a strong growth expected in the few years ahead. And we expect to grow the online population to grow just under over 91 million online consumers in 2017. So how can you benefit from this huge European online audience? And what do you need to know about Russia before you dive in? Well, Russia, and I named this section specifically the complexity of Russia, because Russia is a very complex country with regards to culture, with regards to politics, as well as pure geographically, and I will show you some examples. So companies that are thinking about moving into or actually expanding their presence in Russia, they need to make sure that they get a good understanding of the market dynamics, the political structure, and as well as consumer sentiments in order to be successful. So today I'll cover some of the basics. Let's start with geography. Sorry. Let's start about with geography first. This is actually a picture of Russia, and Russia is the largest country in the world. On population size, it's not the largest. It has 143 million people, which is the ninth largest country in the world by population. But if you look at size, it's the largest country by area. So it has about 17 million square kilometers, and as I'm on a metric system, I'm not sure how that translates to miles, but it's huge, huge country. It has lots of big cities, so Russia is more than just Moscow, which many people know, St. Petersburg. In fact, Russia has over 1,000 major cities and has 16, have actually a metro population of more than 1 million. So when you think about large cities in Russia, it's Moscow, it's St. Petersburg, but it's also Nizhny Novgorod, it's Novosibirsk, and it's Yekaterinburg. Most of the large cities are actually located at the west side of the country. And although Moscow is not the only city, it is a very important center of commerce. It's the capital of Russia. It has over 12 million residents. It's the country's major economic as well as political center, and it's the home of the president, the government, and the state, Duma. So all of that Russia just defies, as we call it, a brief description. It covers 9 time zones. In 2010, some of the time zones has been put together, so it moved from 11 to 9 time zones in 2010. it has all the climate zones except the tropical. It lands, actually stretches almost halfway around the planet. It takes 8 hours to fly from Moscow to Vladivostok, and a train ride is at least four days minimum. It's a huge, huge country. And it's not just that it's huge in size, but it immediately also uncovers one of the major challenges that Russia is dealing with, which is its infrastructure, or more important, its lack of infrastructure. So the country is just not equally accessible everywhere. If you think about road as well as rail infrastructure, that really is a problem. So I have a graphic here that shows the roads per 100 square kilometer. And if you compare, for example, Russia to the US, Russia only has a very low number of roads per square kilometer. And that doesn't even take the quality of the roads into account, as you can see from this picture here. There are some serious issues. The transport system that Russia is dealing with is very heavily Moscow-centric. Everything almost starts from Moscow or ends there. And if you think about commercial transportation, that relies heavily on rail. Russian trucking industry is minimally developed. Roads are not designed to carry heavy long-distance truck traffic. So, of course, why I'm telling you all this, why I'm showing you this, because this this has a big impact on digital developments and on trends like e-commerce. And we'll look into that issue a little bit later. So that are some of the challenges, but there's also there's a huge opportunity, because Russia is simply said, it's a huge consumer market, and especially from a European perspective, it's the largest European consumer market. So although it's a very diverse market, just think about it, there's more than 160 ethnic groups in Russia. They speak more than 100 languages amongst each other, amongst these 160 ethnic groups. But they all speak Russian, which is very helpful. It's the official language, and it's almost understood and spoken and written by almost everyone. There is a little challenge that Russia is facing at this moment. It's a demographical challenge, because its population actually has been steadily declining since the fall of the Soviet Union, mainly due to low birth rates and extremely high debt rates. And it's a little bit of a side note, but I thought it was interesting to share. In 2011, for example, the average life expectancy in Russia was 64 years for men and 76 years for female. That gap, 12 years, but then the 12-year gap is the biggest difference in the world between men and women. And one of the big reasons is drinking. It's alcohol related. Alcoholism among men is believed to explain much of this large difference in Russia. But just a side note, it is a huge consumer market, and even with these challenges as demographics going down, it's still 143 million consumers, and as I said, it's the biggest consumer market in Europe. Another thing that's very interesting is Russia has the highest GDP per capita of all the BRIC markets, and BRIC markets is Brazil, Russia, India, and China, which means that Russian consumers have more money to spend than those in other BRIC economies. And following the collapse of the Soviet Union, which is only 20 years ago, Russia moved from a planned economy at that stage to a free market, and it actually opened up its borders quite rapidly to foreign businesses and investors. And the Russian government, if you compare it, for example, to China, or is very proactive in supporting, for example, the ruble to secure the economy and to reassure its investors. So the ruble is actually the official currency, which trades at around $1 is about 30 rubles. And although it's illegal for Russian stores to accept currency other than rubles, some retailers actually display their prices in conventional units, as they call them. And especially you will see that if you travel around, you will see that for example, Moscow, in luxury stores where there is the product is actually priced in conventional units, which is most often linked to either the dollar or the euro exchange rate. So that's about the GDP, and that Russians actually do have some money to spend on average. But also Russia has a very educated population, which is another, as I mentioned, some of the growth factors why countries would move up to the on the S-curve of online adoption. It was money to spend as well as an educated population. Well, Russia has a very educated population. Urban Russians consumers are highly educated, and 33%, for example, have a university degree or higher, which is only compared to only 27% of Europeans and 29% in the U.S. And Russians are also much more likely to have full-time employment if you compare it with other European countries. About 3/4 of the population of Russia is actually urban. They live 3/4 live in an urban environment. And that is interesting to know, because there's actually a divide in Russia between rural, urban, and metropolitan areas with regards to behavior as well as lifestyle. So if you think about the Russian middle class, they're younger, they're better educated, and they're wealthier than the average Russian population. And as I said, its members live predominantly in big cities. They are more actively involved in innovative economic sectors. They are more entrepreneurial, and they're more sophisticated in their financial behaviors. You also see that the share of the middle class in consumption and products bought by far exceeds that of other groups within the Russian society. It's an interesting group to target. What we also see is, if you look at Forrester's technographics data, it shows that an average household income of urban Russian consumers is about just under 30,000 rubles a month, which is about $1,000. But this number is significantly higher for people who are under the age of 35 or Russians who live in the major metropolitan areas of Moscow or St. Petersburg. This metropolitan group also has a different attitude and lifestyle. Russian consumers tend to be impulsive buyers, especially if you compare them to Western European. Fewer of them, for example, say that they shop around before making a final purchase. They are much more likely and much more willing to try new things as long as it's consistent with their image. So that's really still very important for this group of consumers. And these attitudes are even stronger in major cities, again, at like Moscow and St. Petersburg. People who live there assign bigger importance to brands, with almost half of them stating that owning the best brand is important to them, and that ads actually help them to buy products. So they're very receptive to advertising, they're very receptive to brands, and they like to spend their money. So this is a little bit giving you an insight about why Russia is complex and the different dynamics that's going on. But it's a complex but at the same time very intriguing region. So the next part of my presentation will actually give you a bit more detail into technology adoption. So when I look at Forrester's technographic segmentation, and we look at technology adoption across different countries, and then we see that actually 60% of Russians are what we call technology optimists. And technology optimists are consumers who believe that technology improves their life. And because of their relative high disposable income, their higher education, and And this technology optimism, it actually results in a big interest in technology and a big uptake of technology. So when you, before I dive into the numbers, I really wanted to show, give you a little bit more information about where the data comes from, because you will see lots of numbers. And I just wanted to give you a little bit of background where the, where we collect these numbers and where they come from. So FIRST has been actually tracking consumer behaviors specifically with regards to technology since 1997 in the U.S. We then moved our survey, because it's a different kind of surveys that we do. We moved surveys over to Europe in 1999, and we added Asia Pacific and Latin America later. And in 2010, we actually added Russia as a specific country. So we interview on an annual basis about 333,000, I think it's actually now 350,000 surveys, so people about their technology behaviors in 20 countries globally. And we use that kind of information to see how trends develop within a certain country, like in this instance Russia, as well as how they compare across different countries. So this is my first data slide. So you will actually see that PC, internet, and broadband adoption in rural, in urban Russia is really catching up. Although it's not at the level of in other European countries, and you will see that there's quite some interest in, and it's actually quite decent uptake of PC at home, online, internet access, as well broadband at home. So Russia's telecommunication system is in a kind of revolutionary stage. Of course, I mentioned about the change of and the fall of the Soviet Union, which is about 20 years ago. And of course, since then, the country's phone system and telecom systems have made a significant change and development. So if you look at PC, broadband, internet adoption, it is still lower than the European average. But the high level of technology optimism, which I mentioned before, makes it very important to monitor the interest, the uptake, and the trends. Internet penetration in urban Russia is lagging behind Western Europe, but it's actually in line with some of the markets that we follow, which is Italy or Poland, where internet penetration is only at 58% and 60% respectively. So if you look at these numbers, it is actually quite in line. Only a third of urban Russians have high-speed broadband at home, and that is quite low, but it is not really surprising, because as I mentioned, the country is so large, it makes it challenging to create an infrastructure that delivers fast broadband to every home. It also has another side effect, which is a price, because it also creates, and the challenges with the infrastructure also create a huge price difference in internet connections across the country. So an average monthly subscription fee in Moscow is around $6. Well, if you want internet, if you want internet at home in the Far East region of Russia, you'd pay six times as much. So, of course, you will see that's an issue. We ask always people who don't have a PC why they don't have a PC, and in most Western European countries, people who don't have a PC, they tell us, like, I don't need one. I don't see a reason. It's not relevant for my life. I don't understand computers. That's the kind of reasons that we normally get. However, in urban Russia, the number one reason for people not to have a PC is price. So price is much more a barrier than what we see in some of the other European countries. So if you look at an average online Russian, urban Russians are generally more positive toward technology compared to those in Western Europe. Russian online consumers are very active online, About 81% goes online every day. 86% uses social networks, and they're spending over 14 hours online each week. Although overall internet uptake is lower than in many other markets that we track, the consumers that are online are more active than their peers in, for example, the UK or in Germany. Also, another interesting fact is that they're very much entertainment focused. So they are far more receptive than Western Europeans to entertainment-based devices and media such as MP3 players, tablets, or interactive media entertainment. So one of the activities where Russians are very active is social media. One of the reasons is by the time most people in Russia came online, which is in the previous slide I showed that the average Russian consumer is online for about 4 years. So by the time most people in Russia came online, social media was an established online activity. So if you look at the West, we had to, we started with search, we started with serving, and we added social network, social media to our online activities. For emerging markets, it's the same in China. For them, the internet is social because social was the internet when they came online. So the result is that although overall internet penetration is lower, consumers that are online show a high level of social media engagement. What you see here is what we call Forrester's social technographics ladder, which actually groups consumers based on their social activities. And we see that Russians are very active social users. So more than half of urban Russians are creators, that are the individuals who produce and publish content, which is just 24% in the U.S. And according to Comscore data, Russians are the most avid social media junkies in the world. They spend close to 10 hours per month, and they spend more than twice as much time on social media networks than the global average. Part of this can be explained by the low internet penetration, so the existing internet user skews towards a technology elite, so to say. But another part can be explained by the ease of access. So social has an other element to it than how we know it, let's put it that way. So it's ease of access to illegal music, illegal movies through Russian social media sites. The website, and my Russian is not as good as it should be, but it's called Free Contact You. So it's the contact, I could translate it, which is the number one social networking site. It looks a lot like Facebook. In fact, if I would show it to you, you would probably think it is Facebook because even the color scheme is exactly the same. But it has a couple of more stickier applications like file sharing, like pirated music, like pirated movies, and lots of games. So all of that makes that people spend a lot of time on social platforms. Then another interesting online activity, of course, is e-commerce, online buying. And online retail has great potential in Russia. In 2011, the sales volume of online retail was around $10 billion in Russia. That was actually already similar to the sales volume in Italy, in Spain, or Brazil, but it's significantly behind what we see in the U.S. or in Europe overall. Also, just to put it in perspective, the share of online retail as a share of the total retail was around 2% in 2011, and it's about somewhere between 7 and 9% in the USA and in most Western European countries. However, having that said, we do see that Russian consumers have started adopting e-commerce. And for example, 89% of online Russians have researched the product in the past 3 months, and they spend on average $200. If you look at the products they research and they buy, mobile phones are researched most. Clothing and accessories are bought most often. As mentioned before, and then there's a couple of frictions, and one of the main frictions in the Russian e-commerce is the lack of digital payment. As you see here in this slide, you don't see it here, but more than half actually, 53% paid for a product on delivery. And in fact, if you look at it, depending on the sector, for some sites, up to 80% of online sales are made on a cash on delivery basis. And that's, for example, the case for Osun .Russia, which is the Amazon of Russia, so to say. So they send the goods, and then it's paid by when the recipient gets the product. And as I said before, it's not just payment that's a challenge, it's also logistics and delivery. And there's a couple of major retailers that are overcoming this by building their own capacities, their own delivery capacities. But of course, that means that you have to have the means to do so. Overall, there are about 25 e-commerce players at this moment, but only 10 of them make 100 million or more. But there's lots of good news as well. If you look at our technographics data, it shows that there has been a significant increase in online shopping in the past year alone, where we found that around 57% of online Russians had bought something online in 2011. This actually had increased to 76%, so 10 percentage points in our latest survey in 2012. And if you then also take into account that steep growth curve, so it's not just that more people are buying, but there's also more people online. So there's a significant number of new shoppers in the last year alone. And although I just mentioned that small ticket items like clothing and books top the list of categories bought, the average spending in Russia per online buyers is already comparable to what we find, for example, in countries like Spain and Italy. And the total e-commerce market is predicted to amount to somewhere between 23 to 30 billion in 2015, give or take 7 billion, which actually corresponds to 5% of total retail volume. So that's up from the 2% that I mentioned before. For reference, that's the same level of the U.S. in 2008. So meaning that Russia is approximately 10 years behind by this measure. So there's no doubt by nobody that Russia will become one of the largest online retail markets, at least in Europe and probably globally. And there's a huge growth potential for online retailers. And one of the good things is that the competition on the Russian e-commerce scene is relatively low compared to for example, China or Brazil, not to mention mature Western countries. So infrastructure from broadband to electronic payment to logistics, that's a problem, but it's slowly changing, and there's some significant improvements going on. But you have to realize that for foreign companies to succeed in Russia, e-commerce, a strong knowledge of the local specifics is required. Some other topic that I wanted to cover is mobile behaviors. Because Russia has, it's not only the largest country, it's not only in Europe, but it also has the largest mobile market in Europe. And a number of mobile networks operators actually exist, but the three biggest ones is MTS, it's Fimplecom, and it's Megaphone. And I'm doing this in the American way, and not their real Russian's name, but these three actually dominate. The majority of mobile subscribers have a pay-as-you-go subscription. And as you can understand, that impacts mobile usage and mobile behaviors. However, what we saw earlier that Russian consumers are lagging behind somewhat in PC and internet adoption, but they absolutely make up for it when it comes to mobile. In fact, more than half of urban Russians tell us that they feel disconnected from the world when they don't have their mobile phones with them. And for 17% of urban Russians, mobile phone users, their phone is the first place they turn to when they need to find information, which is only about 8% in other Western European markets. Another role that mobiles have in Russian consumers' life is that of as an entertainment device. It's their MP3 player, it's their portable game console, it's the video player all in one. Which also means they're far more receptive than Europeans to marketing messages on their phone. And they're not as concerned about privacy issues as we see in other countries. So it is definitely a fertile market for anything mobile. And this is, for example, also reflected within the growing availability of mobile payment options. Payment is an issue, and there's not many uptake of bank accounts or credit card is quite low in Russia, but telcos actually have taken the lead in creating mobile payment systems in Russia. I mentioned already Fimbocom, MTS, and Megaphone. They are partnering with banks to allow consumers to pay for utilities, to pay for transit tickets, to pay for entertainment, to pay for other services, including online services. And they have launched services that connect mobile accounts and card payments. One of these services is Ruru. It allows to transfer funds between personal accounts to other mobile subscribers, to electronic wallets, to bank card accounts, but also, to e-commerce. And this is actually a big, big step in the Russian market. Another development that we've seen is that earlier this year, Russian Post has signed an agreement with MasterCard to jointly develop and commercialize a range of what they call innovative financial products. So as a first step, 2,000 of the Russian 42,000 post offices will be equipped to accept a kind of what they call PayPass, contactless payment. It's a near-field communication, and they're also looking at if they can put it on an app as a mobile payment system. So, and where we see in many other European and probably in the U.S. as well, and where mobile payment struggles because consumers don't have a need for another card, they don't have a need for another payment method, you actually see that the opposite in Russia, because of all these challenges that Russian consumers have with mobile, mobile payment actually fills a void. It fills a real need that consumers have. So there is a high willingness to use mobile peer-to-peer payment systems or some of these new initiatives. Because they're really looking outside of the existing financial system for innovative ways to manage the money. And with that, giving a short summary, and then I'm handing over to Jeff. So there's no doubt in my mind that Russia is a market in development, but with huge potential. Two technology trends, very important to take away today. PC uptake, the first one is that PC uptake has already reached the same adoption level as in some southern European countries, and Russians will turn immediately to the next generation of computers when they become when cheaper alternatives become available, which will result in a fast-growing internet population. Secondly, make sure to keep an eye on mobile in Russia. Russia's mobile internet uptake is at the level of most Western European countries, even with the challenges with mobile and data plans in Russia. It's not convenient for using mobile internet; still, people use it. It's very common for Russian consumers, for example, to have multiple SIM cards for different uses. The continuous development of the 3G network and the better mobile plans will attract more consumers to the mobile internet in the next few years. And Russians love their mobile phones. They're very receptive to new mobile services. So these two developments give companies a good platform to reach consumers with services and products. But consumer attitudes are changing. So until recently, Russia was a technology country in development, and consumers were already okay with the sometimes challenging services offered. However, with growing accessibility, with better connections, and a maturing internet population, expectations will go up, and there is a need for better support and better services. And with that, I'd like to hand it over to Jeff. So Jeff, please go ahead.
Great. Thank you so much, Reinicke. Really appreciate it. Wanted to remind everyone to please enter questions in the Q&A section of ON24. And let me introduce Jeff Kim, COO and President of CD Networks, Americas and EMEA.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Reinicke. It's a privilege to be speaking to everyone today. I think that was a terrific overview by Forrester. I'm going to customize or tailor my presentation to really focus in on what CD Networks' specialty is, which is internet infrastructure and web applications. So I'll cover a bit and kind of summarize the opportunities and challenges that Reinicke mentioned. This one infographic kind of highlights or summarizes everything that's been said, that Russia is an incredibly large growth opportunity. That's what we're seeing. That's what the customers that are coming to talk to us about are seeing. Largest online population in Europe. It's only 40% penetration and growing. Close to 100% or more in mobile penetration. E-commerce, $10 billion in 2011, growing to $30 billion in 2015. So, you know, large GDP, well-educated consumer base and end users. So a huge market opportunity. So the customers that we see that are approaching us don't see Russia as an optional, region. It's a mandatory one. So instead of just battling it out in well-developed places like the U.S. or Europe, where you're trying to extract, 1% or 1.5% growth, folks are reaching out into the emerging markets, or better, how we term growth markets, into the Russias, into the Chinas, into the Brazils and of the world. And so Russia cannot be ignored. However, the challenges, and just to elaborate on top of what Reinicke said, as well as introduce some more of the technical challenges, is end users are spread across vast geographies. So as she mentioned, 1,000 cities, 9 time zones. So, placing a data center or your web application hosted in Moscow will not cover the thousands of cities and 9 time zones. It is physically impossible. And Moscow and St. Petersburg does not equate to Russia. So fragmented network topology, limited internet exchange points, poor connectivity between networks, those are a reality every day. So somewhat of what we saw in the early days of the U.S. internet with, limited peering points and almost a decade or 15 years ago is what we're kind of seeing in the growth markets, and definitely what we're seeing in Russia. Lack of payment system. So a lot of the prospects and customers we see there are saying, hey, there's the credit card systems aren't rolled out there yet. But as Reinicke mentioned, the mobile payments are going to be leapfrogging or jumping past that medium and going on to the next. And we know for a fact that the large providers like MasterCard and Visa, et cetera, are pouring a lot of innovation, R&D budget, as well as growth funds into Russia as well. Mobile penetration is, again, close to or above 100%, but 3G is only 7%. So you can look at that as a glass half empty, but we see that as a glass half full. Again, significant growth opportunities for those people that view our sentiment that Russia is a mandatory region that they must reach. Okay? More on the challenges, and I like showing this nice 3D graph. Don't try to interpret it, but basically on the left-hand side are some cities where our points of presence, where we've put some of our POPs or points of presence servers, and on the right-hand side are other cities in the globe, including places like San Jose and London and Paris and Seoul and Tokyo. So we took this on a particularly bad day. So this isn't every day within Russia, but on a particularly bad network day, we were seeing on the levels of 10% packet loss. That means that it's just basically on the underlying technology of the internet, 10% of content packets that are flowing over get lost, and they have to be retransmitted, which require delays and slowdowns and broken connections. Okay, so as a point of reference, in the U.S., if we start seeing 1% packet loss, then all the network IT people start basically freaking out. And here in Russia, we see 2, 3, 8, and 10% packet loss. So there are connectivity and reliability problems there, but that can get that need to be overcome. Okay, a bit about, again, focusing on CD networks and what we do for Russia, and our product, our service is actually called Russia Acceleration. We are a global CDN or content delivery network. We have infrastructure and points of presence all around the globe, but specifically we're very focused on Russia as well. In-depth knowledge of Russia's business government landscape as well as tight relationships with networks and ISPs. We have a strong relationship or strategic partnership with Megaphone, which is a large telco mobile operator, one of the largest in Russia, as well as a strategic partnership with Telehouse, which is a global data center player in the world. We partner with them for our network within Russia. We're experts on the Russians' unique internet environment, and we offer a full suite of services and products that will extend your web application or your website into Russia. And conversely, we take Russian e-businesses and extend them out of Russia into the rest of the globe as well, into places like China, Brazil, the U.S., Europe, South America, etc. So both directions. Our current network map, we have 13 points of presence within Russia and growing. We have over 100 global POPs that we add to that outside of Russia. We are continuing to invest there. Like we mentioned before, one POP doesn't do it. 13 POPs gets us reasonable performance, and we're continuing to expand as our demand and our growth expands. A bit about our service, or Russia Acceleration service, in a very high level. A lot of people think, okay, and you'll see on the top side, build out a data center. So I want to get my banking application or my e-commerce application or my hotel travel application into Russia. Well, I need to replicate my data center in Moscow, and that will fix it. That will not fix it. On top of that, it's very expensive. It's difficult to sync, data between your existing, let's say, data center or origin in the U.S. or in Europe, and then putting that into Russia, and then syncing up, and then having IT and technical resources to maintain that CapEx and OpEx. That's a very difficult thing to do, and actually almost most of the time that's what our customers come to us with their existing solution. That's what they think they need to do. What we do is basically we say leave your origin or your data center where it is. So if it's in London, leave it in London. If it's in Tokyo, leave it in Tokyo. What we'll do is over our global network, we will accelerate your website or web application using our global footprint of points of presence. And our 13 points of presence within Russia will be your extended data center. So it's like the equivalent of lighting up 13 data centers within Russia anyway. We'll take the cacheable pieces. These are your logos, your JPEGs, your videos, your media, and serve them locally once we cache them within Russia. Your dynamic elements, what we'll go ahead and do is we create a optimally tuned TCP link over our network. So to boil that down to layman's terms, we kind of create a next-generation internet between our points of presence. So we will maximize data transfer for these dynamic transactions. And these dynamic transactions mean things like personalized content that can't be cached. There are stock tickers or things that are changing every second, every minute, or booking engine transactions or shopping cart transactions. And you think that these, you know, these dynamic transactions are fast or quick. They're not. Again, for the very things that we mentioned before, of the internet problems, packet loss, poor connectivity, et cetera. So our recommendation here is leave your data center where it is. No need to bring up another data center. And we will work with you to speed up both your cacheable content and dynamic transactions. Our performance in Russia is as expected, number one. So we this is a Sodexis is a neutral third-party monitoring company. They have basically agents throughout the world. It's also in Russia, and they are constantly measuring how different cloud providers, different CDN providers perform. And we are again because of our network technology as well as our strategic partnerships, we're number one in Russia. Another performance graph, and we throw up Akamai here just because a lot of people know them here. So the top line shows what would be a your performance, and this was a single object, a small logo on someone's page. What would it be out of your origin data center? Then the middle line is how fast does that get loaded through Akamai, and then the bottom line, which is very close to zero, is how fast does that load through CD networks. And again, it makes sense just because we're there, we're local, we're accelerating both cacheable and dynamic. So let me end this off with success stories. So a lot of kind of technical diagrams, but how does that really relate to actual success stories? So one success story we have is Jimdo. They are a provider of kind of social, basically websites that people put up. It actually is doing very well in Russia. Before they used our services, their origin or their data center was actually hosted in Germany. It was taking roughly 14 seconds for their page to load. And again, this is both their dynamic content, website content, as well as their static. And because they're highly personalized websites, you know, a lot of it can't be cached. By going with our Russia acceleration solution, we got them down to 5 seconds. So a significant decrease. And, of course, on the right-hand side, you'll see that because of the increased performance, their Russian traffic end users, unique end users, started increasing. So performance equals happier end users, which equals happier revenue, happier revenue, increased revenue. Okay. One more case study, very similar kind of type of story. iOffer. They had their origin, I think, let me take a look here. Their origin is in Texas, so a little bit further away from Russia, but here in the U.S., in Texas. They went live with us, and we got their page load down, reduced it by 80%. And they also launched a Russian language website as well, and you'll see the red line on the bottom. As soon as their performance improved, their Russia traffic significantly started to ramp up. So again, these are early tech innovators and folks that are you know, seeing that the emerging markets are growth markets for them and competitive differentiators. We're also working with more established enterprises like banks, hotel, travel, you know, other like type SaaS, cloud, ERP type solutions. That you know, want to get their web applications faster, both in and out of Russia as well. So that concludes you know, our overall presentation. We can hand it over back to Sharon for questions.
Great. Yeah, I think we have time for a couple questions. So we have one from an audience member. They ask, as an e-commerce vendor of consumer goods, when should we start expanding to Russia? So, Ronnie, do you
want to
take that?
Yeah, well, I would say the sooner the better, because as I mentioned in my presentation, competition is low now, is low, not slow, but competition is low. There's not that many competitors. There's the acceleration of online shoppers as well as online consumers is now. So, and As with anything, if you get them now and you can increase loyalty and you can actually give them the service they are looking for and the products they need, and you will build a good customer base and can expand. So I would definitely say now.
Great, thank you. Another question for you is, are Russian consumers and businesses okay with English language on the websites?
No. Of course, there is no, and I was just going to expand on it. I mentioned in my presentation there's 100 different languages, and Russia is almost the common language between already all these different languages. Because of the history, English is not a second language as it is in other European countries. It's also a reason why, for example, uptake of Facebook is much, much lower than you see in other countries. Because of the language, so you can do it, but you have to realize that you will be able to attract only a very limited group of consumers, highly educated, and probably with some experience abroad. So if you really want to appeal to this 143 million Russian consumers, or the 91 that we will have online in 2017. You have to have a Russian website.
Great. And then we have a similar one to the e-commerce one, but as far as like booking sites for the travel industry, and I'm assuming hotels and airlines, when do you think those will become popular in Russia?
Oh, that's an interesting one. I have to say I don't have the numbers on travel on top of mind. So it's funny because travel is always in, if you look at what products consumers are buying in markets, travel is always in the top three of researched and bought, especially airline tickets. I know that in Russia, because of the history again, there's less a culture of going on holiday and going abroad. However, I can't answer that question without diving into my data deeper. So I sorry, I have to pause that one.
Oh, no problem. This one's for Jeff. Is there an alternative to accelerating the content through a CDN like CD Networks, or is there any other vendors doing this?
In a self-serving comment, I'll say no, to be quite honest. Right now, CD Networks is the only one that's doing both dynamic and static, as well as having our large footprint within Russia. There are some local players there that they focus on, you know, simple caching of media, a lot of folks doing like video streaming, but not core transactional-based applications. Even the global players, they have a point of presence within Moscow, and that's their coverage. The other thing is, in one of my slides, I forgot to mention that, you know, routing around problems is one of the key things that need to be done. Where, again, if we see a network link between one city or another where you were seeing, you know, high packet loss or things are going wrong, our system will route around that and actually kind of boomerang around to a different point of presence to get to that end location. Without kind of our CDN technology, that would not work, and basically your end users would be you know, dropped off.
Great. Well, thank you so much. We're at the top of the hour. Don't want to take people's time longer than we had committed to. So I want to thank everybody for joining us, Aranike and Jeff for presenting. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Bye-bye.